There's no doubt that EFI has made a big impact on the sort of horsepower levels, the ETs and the mile an hour that we're seeing in drag racing circles. And we're here with Larry Larson, who is the owner of the world's fastest streetcar. His Chevy S10 truck has gone as quick as 589 on the quarter and has run as fast as 244 mile an hour. Now, Larry, you've been a long time drag racer, and I'm guessing that you've been brought up initially on the carburettor years, and you've transitioned into EFI. And how hard initially was that to move from tuning carburetors to electronic fuel injection?
Well, a screwdriver doesn't work very good on a laptop to start with, but it was a change. It was a welcome change because, like with anything else, you want to be out there doing stuff that nobody else is doing. So it was good, once again, a learning experience for sure.
You've been a fairly early adopter of EFI. I think you said to me that you'd been running EFI for as long as 20 years now. And back then, the technology with EFI certainly wasn't anywhere near what we've got today. Now, how have you seen that EFI market change, and how has that helped you go faster and faster?
Well, technology has done, you know, amazing things. I was on both sides of it 20 years ago. I helped a customer with the first EFI car in Comp Eliminator in NHRA with a Motec system, and then I had an antiquated old Excel system that I purchased for my own use in 97. So, you know, I had both ends of the spectrum, but with technology advancing as like it has, then, you know, things just keep getting better and better and better, and it's not every year, it's every month or two now.
And when we're talking about a fairly low-powered street engine, obviously the tuning envelope is quite wide, but when we're talking about some of these pro mod style twin turbo engines being used in drag cars, making 2,000, 2,500, 3,000 horsepower, that tuning window becomes so much narrower and it's much easier to hurt an engine. So why is the EFI so critical in getting the sort of power levels out of those engines?
Well, you can adjust everything from RPM wise to boost wise, the thing that you can't do with, let's say, a blow through carburetor. So you have the ability to adjust cylinder-cylinder timing, cylinder-cylinder fuel delivery. Well, once again, like at RPM, different RPM, different boost levels. So that really plays into it. And then because of what it is, just like my truck running on a dual fuel, driving the thing on gasoline and then racing the thing on methanol, you know, I can change. It takes longer for me to change the fuel system as far as the hoses and how the fuel flows into the engine than it does for me to change it. It takes about 5 seconds on the fuel tech to change it on the screen to go from a methanol map to a gas map and back.
I want to touch on that a little bit, but before we get more into the setup on your truck, tuning, generally a lot of tuners require a dyno, or feel like the best results they're going to get require a dyno. And you said to me before we started this interview that you've never actually used a dyno. So yeah, talk to us a little bit about that. Do you feel that having access to a dyno would be an advantage, or do you see that there are more advantages in tuning under real world conditions at the actual track?
Well, I think if you don't have any map to start out with, then maybe the dyno would be beneficial. But once again, I've never been on the dyno per se with any of my turbocharged applications, so, or any customer stuff for that matter. So I can see it being an advantage to some point, but at the end of the day, we're out on the racetrack or we're out on the highway, and those are real world conditions, and that's what you have to tune it for.
I think that real-world conditions is a really critical part, because I've been a big-time advocate of, even with access to a really good quality dyno bed, an engine dyno, a chassis dyno, or whatever, it's almost impossible to replicate the airflow and temperatures that you're actually going to see at, you know, 200-plus mile an hour, and that does have a serious effect on the tune-up.
Yes, correct, because if you've got air inlets in the hood or don't have any air inlets in the hood, or wherever the thing's getting air at, is that's going to change. It's going to change for outside air temperature, if it's picking up heat off the racetrack. And then from a drivability standpoint, you take one out and fire it up and run it on the dyno for whatever, 5 minutes, 15 seconds, whatever the number is, you can't duplicate the going out and driving the thing and heat soaking the thing after 30, 40, 50 miles.
Okay, so to move on to your Chevy S10 truck, so with EFI and engines making huge power, actually, how much power are you estimating that engine's producing?
Yeah, I'm guessing the thing probably makes in the neighborhood of 3,300.
So with that sort of power level, particularly when you're running on methanol fuel in a drag event, you need a huge amount of fuel when you're running methanol. So how are you handling that? It's one thing we've seen over the last probably decade at least is the availability of larger fuel injectors has improved. But how are you running that system, the fuel system in the Chevy?
I've got Billet Atomizer injectors in it currently. I've got a 245 and an 850, and if I was running it strictly on alcohol and just racing it, I'd probably have twin 700s to supply that the amount of fuel that I need. But because I drive it and run it on gasoline, that's why it's got a 245 and an 850 in it, because when I drive it, it just runs on the 245, which makes it nice. It's real crisp and clean, even on methanol at part throttle, and then the 850 is then it's staged in at a later date, and with the Fuel Tech, it becomes really smooth. You don't even know it comes in.
So that Fuel Tech ECU, another thing that the Fuel Tech ECU does that I'm aware of is they run an external control box for the injectors. And this is a problem when you're running a V8 engine and you're running stage injection. Now you've got 16 low impedance injectors. Each of those injectors is drawing quite a lot of current, and a lot of the ECUs with internal injector drivers can struggle under those sort of conditions to accurately control the injectors. Is that a reasonable sort of way of explaining things?
Yes, and the other thing I like about it is that if you would have a driver failure, in a lot of the boxes, the drivers are internal. So now you've got to send the box back, have a spare box, whatever. With the Fuel Tech and the external drivers, each driver powers four injectors. So you just change out that driver if you ever have an issue, which I never have. But you have that capability, and you're not married to what's going on in the ECU of the unit itself.
So serviceability at the track, the ability to have spares, becomes a whole lot easier.
Yes, it's the only downside is that it's a little bit more stuff to mount, but in the same token, the actual ECU for the Fuel Tech is considerably smaller than anybody else's ECU that I'm aware of.
Now, with the other drive we've seen in drag racing circles, going back 10 years or so, we've seen cars with multiple electronic boxes, ones for fuel control, ones for ignition control, bump boxes, etc. And now we're seeing, with more technology being applied to the aftermarket ECUs available, everything's being brought down into one box. Can you talk to us about how that's affected your own car?
Yeah, when we first put the truck together, we had multiple systems. I had a separate boost controller, a separate bump box, separate ignition. Basically the Fuel Tech at that point in time just did the EFI part of it. But now with the technology has been and the updates that they've done and the new FT600 that they brought out in the spring, now I've got the Fuel Tech, the 600, just running everything. It does the bump box, the traction control if I want to use it, the boost control, it'll do coil on plug, so I could, it will do everything, which makes that really nice that you don't have to plug into three or four different modules or three or four different systems and then chase that around on your laptop trying to decide what you want to do. On top of the fact that it also has the data recording capabilities now that we installed one in a customer's car this spring and used it for the complete data recording capability, doing converter pressure and shock travels and everything. So now you've got one system that does everything, so you're not flipping from screen to screen to screen, which makes it a lot faster and less complicated from a tuner standpoint.
Now, you've also just mentioned the boost control and you've mentioned traction control. I just want to dig into those two topics a little bit. So particularly when you've got potentially 3,300 horsepower thereabouts, certainly off the start line, you're not going to be able to get all of that power to the ground. How critical has accurate boost control become as the power levels have increased?
Well, it has to repeat, because with the turbocharged stuff, if that thing varies a pound of boost, that's a lot of power. And so if it varies, then you're chasing your tail. And it's bad enough on a prep surface. If you go out and run some of this no prep stuff like we've been running this year, it becomes very critical. So you need something that will repeat and that you can manipulate to do what you need it to do.
Now, in terms of making adjustments to that boost pressure run to run, what are you looking at Are you looking at sort of whether or not you've got wheel spin and then adjusting the boost pressure to try and maximize the amount of traction you've got available at the track?
Yeah, you're looking at, once again, like on the no prep stuff or even the prep races, you're basically racing the racetrack. I mean, you're trying to go as fast as you can go at the racetrack. So you're looking at what the wheel speed is doing, what the G meter is doing, and just trying to apply as much power to it as you can. With that becomes gear ratio and converter and everything else. But it's still a matter of trying to produce as much power as you can and repeatable power.
Okay, so now in terms of traction control, so obviously you're going to try and tune the engine to produce optimal power for the amount of traction, but obviously sometimes you get it wrong, maybe the track's gone away slightly and you do end up in a situation with wheel spin. So what's your take on traction control? Is that something that you rely on?
You know, I've been around that since probably 03, 04 with the big stuff units clear back then, and Mike Moran helped a lot in some of the early years. And the traction control is, to me, a fail-safe. It's never the fastest way down through there. It may be it will save a run, but it's usually never the fastest way. So for me, I feel as a tuner, I want to tune this thing where it shouldn't need the traction control. If I'm in a really sketchy service or a really high-dollar race where I want to make sure that I don't do something foolish, then I may turn it on. But a lot of these guys use it run after run after run and use it for a tuning tool, which you can, but my pockets aren't deep enough to be replacing engine parts and some of the stuff that it has a little bit of an effect on using it repeatedly. So I try and stay away from it, but it's there to use and it works really well.
Can you just talk a little bit about how sort of relying on that traction control and running on it, you know, continuously can potentially hurt engine components?
Well, what I've seen and what my engine builder have told me at ProLine is that what they see is if you run one on the dots, as they want to say, where the thing's constantly pulling timing in and out and or maybe misfiring the engine to keep everything in check, is that it gets really hard on crankshafts and crankshaft dampeners. And they've even seen it so bad at times where it would try and weld the crankshaft hub to the crankshaft. So they've done some things there to make that better from that standpoint. But once again, for me, I take more pride in trying to run it without it if I can, but that's not everybody.
I just want to rewind a little bit and just talk about some of the capabilities with the EFI in terms of the individual cylinder tuning capabilities. And this really comes back to what I was saying before. When you're running these sort of engines at that sort of power level, that window for tuning becomes much, much narrower. And it's really important to make sure that all eight cylinders are receiving a safe air fuel ratio. So how are you going about making those sort of adjustments?
Well, it depends on what combination you have. If it's a blown combination or a nitrous combination, you know, you can run a lambda or an O2 in every pipe, but a turbocharged application, you're basically running one behind each turbo. So the cylinder to cylinder you're relying on, still reading the spark plug. You can look at some EGT stuff. The EGTs will give you an idea, but it's still, depending on placement and the header and all that, it's never the same engine to engine. So at the end of the day, you're still looking at a spark plug and trying to make everything as close as you can that way.
So technology's moved on, but still some of the old school ways of reading plugs are still critical.
Yeah, absolutely.
Look, it's been really interesting getting some insight into what makes your car tick there, Larry. And we understand you're going back to Drag Week to try and run into the fives next year. Is that correct?
If the tracks will, they're supposed to announce later on. So if the tracks are good enough that I think we can pull it off, then yeah, that's why I'll go back, because nobody else has been able to do it. So I hope we can get it accomplished for them.
Well, if the tracks are to your liking and you do run back next year, we look forward to seeing you run that first 5-second pass. Thanks for the chat.
Absolutely. Thank you.
If you liked that video, make sure you give it a thumbs up. And if you're not already a subscriber, make sure you're subscribed. We release a new video every week. And if you like free stuff, we've got a great deal for you. Click the link in the description to claim your free spot to our next live lesson. You'll learn about performance engine building and EFI tuning, and you'll also have the chance to ask questions, which I'll be answering live. Remember, it's 100% free, so follow the link to claim your spot.